You too can achieve the American dream if only you work hard enough to conform to society's norms. And by society, I mean white supremacy. And if you assimilate enough, and if you reject all of your non-American culture, history, background, generational trauma, and just get over it so that you again can achieve the American dream, which is white supremacy. Isn't it lovely over here, where you dehumanize yourself to the point where you are no longer recognizable? Not only are you not recognizable, but you have no culture of your own because it's lost to the American dream. Dear white people, these freedoms or the impingement of freedoms that you are ranting and raving about is just silly. You've always had the freedom to do exactly as you please. The only change for you is that you're just now starting to see some consequences for being able to do whatever you please. And I understand that these consequences might feel like persecution, but I can guarantee you it is not. Now, being able to make choices without any accountability or consequences is not freedom. That is terrorism. I should be used to this by now, but I'm not. There is no safe place for BIPOC to exist when whiteness is present. There just isn't. Here's some things that you need to know about me. Number one, if you are a person of whiteness, I don't give a fuck. I don't give a fuck about your comfort. I don't give a fuck about your feelings. I don't give a fuck about where you think that your place is in the world. If my existence and my statements and actions cause you discomfort, then I am doing the right thing. Number two, I am not a person in a skinny body. And I am proud of that. You cannot body shame me and make me feel bad about myself. And in fact, if you're responding to a statement about your patriarchy, racism, sexism, with how my body looks to you, that tells us way more about you and your lack of character and morals than it says about what I'm eating or not eating. And I can put you down in a hot second. My large body will fuck you all the way up. I live in King County, Washington, and we are represented in the county by King County Council. The council member that represents me is an individual named Reagan Dunn. Reagan Dunn is the only council member to vote against declaring racism a public health crisis. So what I want to know, Mr. Reagan Dunn, as you look into my Asian eyes, as you speak to your constituents who are Black, Brown, and Indigenous, how is racism not a public health crisis? And what's perplexing to me is that your solution to address racism is by hiring more police. More police to kill more Black and Brown and Indigenous folks? And when I've called the police to report hate crimes and to report racism, I get laughed at because First Amendment rights. Police are not going to do shit for us. I just got a calendar reminder on my work email that I was supposed to be getting on a plane tomorrow with my family to go to Hawaii to celebrate my grandmother's passing. My beautiful grandmother passed away at 97 years old in February 2020. We were supposed to celebrate her originally in April of 2020, and everything got shut down. Things were looking good this summer. People were starting to get vaccinated, so my family rescheduled it to this weekend. And then you motherfuckers who don't think it's your responsibility to wear a fucking piece of cloth on your face and get a fucking vaccine makes it so that my family cannot celebrate my grandmother for another year. And I want to tell you that that brings up a kind of rage in me. That's only happened a few times in my life. And it all comes down to this. You fucking colonizers. You motherfucking colonizers think you can take and do whatever the fuck you want. And anything that gets in your way is inconsequential to you because it does not affect you. And this is why you're feeling persecuted right now. It's because it's the first time in your motherfucking existence that you're experiencing any sort of accountability. And it's not going to stop until you dismantle the systems that you benefit from that result in the rest of us being harmed. Because of you motherfuckers, my beautiful grandmother has not been put to rest. My beautiful grandmother is not able to be celebrated by her family. Wear the motherfucking mask, get the motherfucking vaccine, and stop being destructive, amoral colonizers. The whole concept of colorblindness is really just an adorable idea. And it really only serves those that are in power, because it allows them to say, I don't see your race, so I don't have to do any self-reflection. I don't see your culture, so I don't have to make any changes. I don't see you. So when you say, good job for being the only one seeing race, or I'm colorblind, or I don't see race, what you're telling me is you don't see me. You don't see my peers. You don't see us. You want us to be invisible so you can remain comfortable. Today I organized and participated in two different racial justice rallies, marches. And people have the audacity to ask what we're rallying for, what we're protesting for, what we're marching for. The audacity to ask this question. And I want to let you know why we're still marching. And we won't stop until it stops. As I navigate this whole campaign management role, something that's really striking to me is how certain people in the opposition, and by opposition I mean anti-equity, racist people, refer to themselves as taxpayers, and that public entities, elected officials, and public servants are accountable to them as taxpayers. And what I'm wondering is, given that the vast majority of us that participate in the systems that we have to live in are taxpayers, which one of us, which subset of us are they accountable to? And what are they accountable for? Is it for our lives? Is it for our humanity? Is it to make sure that we have all the resources we need to survive and thrive? Or are they accountable to make sure that your comfort is undisturbed, that your feelings are unhurt and you are unbothered? So I had a really distressing conversation with a neighbor that I'm trying to process because I'm so upset about it. Somehow my decolonization journey and finding my Okinawan roots came up, and he was really defensive and offended by this. He interrupted me as I was sharing Okinawa's history to say, why does it matter? And to me, what that meant was, why do you matter? And essentially, he was saying, the land that you're from is owned by Japan, so you are Japanese. You should assimilate. Why would you ever say that to someone? Why? This week has been wild. So I am campaign manager for an incredible candidate running for our school board. She is brilliant. She is kind and loving, compassionate. She is generous. She cares about every person in this community, regardless of who they are, what they've done to her. She wants everyone to thrive. That is real. Her opponent, however, is the exact opposite. He's running on three issues. He's anti-equity. He specifically says he's anti-equity because everyone should have the same opportunities, regardless of what the needs are. He is specifically anti-racial equity. He's also anti-mask, anti-vaccine, and he's anti-medically accurate, age-appropriate sex education. This week, on his private Facebook campaign page, there was an attack on me. My pictures were shared. There were threats made against me about coming to find me. I'm going to get a taste of my own medicine, that I'm a pot stirrer, and pretty soon I'm going to have to taste my own spoon. People were hoping to run into me accidentally. As if I wouldn't go motherfucking toe-to-toe with these bitches. All because my entire existence in this community has been around holding people accountable. And when I see racism, I call it out. And so their assumption is that I'm anti-white. I'm not anti-white. I'm pro-accountability. When you are a piece of motherfucking shit, I am going to call you out. I am not sorry that that feels bad. Because imagine what it feels like being on the receiving end of your racism. Holding people accountable is an act of love. It's an act of kindness, and it's an act of community. We are accountable to each other. So when you behave like a horrible human being and you are not held accountable, that is a disservice to the community. That's a disservice to everyone that has to encounter you or see your words. So trust and believe I am going to hold you accountable. And that is not racism, that is not bullying, that is not hate, that is love that you don't deserve from me. Of non-apologies and why you should always call them out and never accept them. Number one, I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings. Number two, I'm sorry that you feel this way. Number three, I'm sorry, but I was only trying to. Number four, I was just trying to say. Number five, I've already explained this, but if this makes you feel better, I'm sorry. Number six, I regret that you feel upset. Number seven, I'm sorry you misunderstood me. Number eight, I will apologize if. Number nine, fine, I'm sorry, are you happy now? And number 10, I have no idea what I need to be sorry for, but I'm sorry. And finally, I'm sorry that I'm right and you're having feelings about it. So here's why you should never accept these apologies. Number one, they're not genuine. Number two, you are worth more than that. Number three, there's clearly a wrong that was done, whether they intended it, whether they realized it or not. There was a harm that was caused, and everyone deserves to be held accountable. Accountability is love. So when I say something that hurts your feelings, or when I say something that harms your humanity, your existence, please call me out, because that is not my intention. But what, as we all know, intention doesn't mean anything when the impact is harmful. So we might say the wrong things. We might say the wrong words. We might have ideology that is so ingrained in us that we don't understand the harm that it causes. We need to do better. We need to learn from each other. And my God, if we hear someone say, you're hurting me or you're hurting someone I care about, listen. This isn't about us. It's about each other. And if we're not taking care of each other in the most basic level, which is identifying and honoring each other's humanity, Then what the fuck are we even doing here? So please don't ever accept a fake apology, a conditional apology, or an apology that's just done so that they can get out of the conversation and out of accountability. Accountability is love. You deserve love. Can we talk about neutrality for a minute? There's definitely times and places in life where neutrality is a necessity. Where finding common ground and, you know, something to connect on is a necessity. But what I'm asking is, if you saw a person being hit, being beaten, would you remain neutral and say nothing, do nothing, because you don't know both sides of the story? Or would you do something? Would you call the police? Would you try and intervene? Would you try and do something to get that person that's being physically harmed to safety? More than likely you would do something. What I'm asking though is, when the abuse isn't something that can be seen, if it's not physical, if you can't see the scars, if you can't see the bruises, would you still remain neutral? And why? So if you are seeing someone experience racism and your first step is to remain neutral, respond in a neutral way, listen to both sides of the story, how does that help the abused? Because racism is abuse. So how does that help the abused? How is that reaction to racism any different than sitting there and watching a child get beat and doing nothing? At what point does neutrality become complicity and direct enablement of abuse? I need some help here. I don't know if I did the right thing culturally. So I live in a suburban sea of whiteness, and I also don't drink. So I'm really just out of touch culturally here. So I need to know if I did the right thing. This is important. So I'm having a very, very, very small outdoor only party for my daughter tomorrow. And there's going to be a couple of mothers there that I don't know well at all. And so I was like thinking, what do white suburban women like to drink? And then I saw White Claw and it's like, oh, this seems like part of the culture. And then I agonized over the flavors because I didn't want it to be like too exotic, right? So did I do the right thing of buying White Claw in a mixed variety, including mango? Is like mango too spicy? Is it too like exotic? Did I do the right thing? Is White Claw the right thing? Is that what white women drink? I don't know. Like, even when I drank, I was like a Maker's Mark kind of girl. So I'm not familiar with this. I'm just really agonizing over this. So just let me know. Thank you. Potentially unpopular opinion here, but I really don't give a fuck. If you are not black and or if you are not indigenous, you should not be making money off of anti-racism work. You should not be making money off of decolonization work. You should not be making money off of diversity, equity, and inclusion work. If you are not black or indigenous, this is our work to do for free. In Black Diamond, Washington, an individual named Corey Bailey is running for Black Diamond City Council. Why is this significant, you may ask? Well, Corey is pretty problematic and really desperate to find a seat politically anywhere. So in 2019, Corey tried to run for Washington's 8th Congressional District for House of Representatives. He got about 2% of the vote in the primary. When he failed that effort, he tried to run a write-in campaign for Washington House of Representatives seat in our district. He failed that too. He also, at the same time when he was attempting a writing campaign, attempted to apply for a vacant position on the local school board. Thankfully, he was not selected. We also heard rumors at this same time when he's trying to do a writing campaign and to get appointed to a seat on the school board that he was also going to go for a vacant seat, which would result in an appointment for Black Diamond City Council. He ended up not doing that because I think that desperation is kind of a stinky cologne. So Corey Bailey claims to be an independent that supports Trump, an independent who expressed disdain for not having a Republican opponent for the Washington State House of Representatives seat that he was attempting to do a write-in for. Why is we talking about this again? Well, he just tried to apply for endorsement from our local legislative district Democrats. Yeah, he, in this form, in this questionnaire, it states, are you a Democrat? He said, yes. So, Mr. Corey Bailey, what I want to know is
this you, Corey Bailey? Is this you? Is this you, Mr. Corey Bailey? Can we talk about this podcast that you were featured on, where they talk about the New World Order, conservative, microchips, fake news, globalism, and by globalism you mean Jews, and transhumanism? I had to look that one up. These people are trying to use science, which is interesting, to become bionic and to live forever. So, this you, Corey Bailey? I'm pretty confused about how you're identifying as a Democrat and why you want a Democratic endorsement. It's pretty unprincipled of you, Mr. Corey Bailey.
Eu quis amar, mas tive medo. E quis salvar meu coração, mas o amor sabe um segredo. O medo pode matar.